lay your head down. Sister, don't you know? Ain't no rest in worry. Troubles come, troubles go. I have seen the sparrow. I have watched her fly. Though she does not worry, tell me why should I? So hold on, love. Things are gonna get better. Things are gonna get better. I know it's hard. Hold on, love. Things are gonna get better. Things are gonna get better. With the wind, open to the sunshine, open to the rain, dressed in all her beauty, given what she needs. If I listen closely, I can hear her sing to me. Hold on, love, things are gonna get better, things are gonna get better. I know it's hard.
How you live, how you die, a sacrifice. So let my life be. Good morning, good morning, good morning. Welcome to St. Stephen's. Thank you so much for coming out in the blizzard, as we said this morning. Whether you're online or here in person, we are so grateful for the gift of your presence. And if there are some first-time guests with us today, we want to especially say thank you to you for finding St. Stephen's, and we want you to get connected. We want you to dive in, jump in, and get connected to the life and the ministry of St. Stephen's. You can find more about us on our website, but also on Facebook and Twitter and Instagram. We hope you will get connected. One of the things that we use is a Connect card. We ask everyone that's in person to fill out a Connect card. And those that are online, you can look in the chat and you can get the link to the online Connect card as well. Tell us about you. Tell us about any changes in numbers or emails or anything else that you need to tell us. Tell us about your prayer concerns and your joys as well. We would love to share those at Tuesday staff meeting and share those with our prayer team as well. I have a message from the Shepherd's Ministry and about their relaunch, and they're looking for others to help. So here, let me just read this from Lori Snyder and encourage you to be involved. The Shepherd's Ministry is a St. Stephen's caring ministry that strives to connect, care for, and provide support to people from the congregation during difficult times, to share God's love, to strengthen our community, and make the life of our church vibrant. In 2022, the Shepherd's Ministry is relaunching with a new and exciting organizational structure. And so that's what we want you to, this is a time to get in on this new opportunity. The ministry is forming care teams and leveraging new communication tools to accomplish its mission. Anyone who might be interested in joining a care team is invited to attend an informational session on Shepherd's Ministry relaunch via Zoom. This coming Thursday and a week from Thursday, you can get that link in our email today and on Wednesday. Also in our email today, we are talking about Lent. Yes, Lent is 17 days away. We're not counting or anything, but it's 17 days away. There's more about the Ash Wednesday service, drive-through ashes, Shrove Tuesday pancake supper by our youth group, the family Lenten pickup for families. Genesis Bells is the newest ensemble that is for beginner ringers. Adults and family and children as well are invited. More information about racial justice and faith discussions and hypothermia is beginning on March the 6th, and there's a sign up also found in our email today. Lots going on in the life of the church. We encourage you to get connected. And so we continue our worship this morning with Pastor Gian bringing us the opening prayer in the children's message.
Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we praise and thank you for your steadfast love. We thank you for this holy space that we are gathering together and be connected with you and with one another. Thank you for your never failing faithfulness, comfort, and grace, which is new every morning and refreshed every day. Thank you that you are a God who cares for each and every one of your children and graciously carries and tends for all who trust in you. We thank you for your ever presence in our lives because you're always with us and you're taking every single step in our lives. Help us to love you more and more with every passing day. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Today, I'd like to share this message with the children of all ages. And the story coming from my favorite book, the Bible. And in the Old Testament, the stories before Jesus is born, there are many, many famous guys in the Bible. And Joseph has lots of good stories in the Bible. Maybe you have heard about his stories. Maybe you heard about his colorful robe, which is a special gift from his father. And that made his brother so jealous of him. So later, the brother actually betrayed him, and he had to leave his brothers and father and his home country. You know what happened to him? So many difficult challenges in his life, but he knew that God is always with me. Even the time he was in prison, you know what? He didn't do anything wrong, but this innocent Joseph ended up being in prison. That's the sad part, right? But even in the time he knew that God is with me. So that challenge gave him a great opportunity to serve some other people in the prison. So whether you are sad or disappointed or frustrated, what kinds of emotions you have today and feelings today you have in your life, God is with us. So let's say all together with one loud voice, God is with us. Do it one more time. God is with us.
God is with us.
Don't forget, whether you are very young or old, I don't know how you see yourself, we all are children of God, and through the story of Joseph, God is teaching us and reminding us of that, the truth. Let's say it one more time. God is with us. Yes, you got it. Let's say our echo prayer. Please repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for teaching us through the story of Joseph. Help us remember you are always with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you please stand as you're able to sing one more song with our service band.
Let us be a generation that sees.
Spirit, come make us humble.
Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you, Source Band. So today we begin a new series, a three-week series titled Joseph in the Movement of the Spirit. This series follows along with our readings from Dive In 2022, in which we're reading right now through Genesis. And if you are not already part of these daily readings, we encourage you to dive in and to pick up where we are towards the end of Genesis and read along with this mini-series. During the series, we will be examining the life of Joseph, one of the 12 sons of Jacob, and the movement of God through the power of the Holy Spirit in his life. And this series has got a lot to teach us about who God is and what God wants for us, but also about God's calling on our lives. And so as we prepare to read our first scripture reading in this series, let us pray, seeking God's illuminating grace. Loving God, you are light, and in you there is no darkness at all. We thank you that we are your children. Help us to hear your words this morning and always to walk in the light of your truth and live in the light of your steadfast love. May the strength of your Holy Spirit reflect the light of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. And from the Hebrew Scriptures, from Genesis chapter 39, we begin with verse 1. Now Joseph was taken down to Egypt, and Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, the captain of the guard, an Egyptian, bought him from the Ishmaelites who had brought him down there. The Lord was with Joseph, and he became a successful man. He was in the house of his Egyptian master. His master saw that the Lord was with him and that the Lord caused all that he did to prosper in his hands. So Joseph found favor in his sight and attended him. He made him overseer of his house and put him in charge of all that he had. From the time that he made him overseer in his house and over all that he had, the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house for Joseph's sake. The blessing of the Lord was on all that he had in house and field. So he left all that he had in Joseph's charge. And with him there, he had no concern for anything but the food that he ate. Now Joseph was handsome and good-looking. And after a time, his master's wife cast her eyes on Joseph and said, "Lie with me." But he refused and said to his master's wife, "Look, with me here, my master has no concern about anything in the house, and he has put everything that he has in my hand. He is not greater in this house than I am, nor has he kept back anything from me except yourself, because you are his wife. How then could I do this great wickedness and sin against God?" And although she spoke to Joseph day after day, he would not consent to lie beside her or to be with her. One day, however, when he went into the house to do his work, and while no one else was in the house, she caught hold of his garment, saying, "Lie with me." But he left his garment in her hand and fled and ran outside. When she saw that he had left his garment in her hand and had fled outside, she called out to the members of her household and said to them, "See, my husband has brought among us a Hebrew to insult us. He came into me to lie with me, and I cried out with a loud voice. And when he heard me raise my voice and cry out, he left his garment beside me and fled outside." Then she kept his garment by her until his master came home, and she told him the same story, saying, "The Hebrew servant whom you have brought among us, came in to me to insult me. But as soon as I raised my voice and cried out, he left his garment beside me and fled outside. When his master heard the words that his wife spoke to him, saying, "This is the way your servant treated me," he became enraged. And Joseph's master took him and put him into the prison, the place where the king's prisoners were confined. He remained there in prison. But the Lord was with Joseph and showed him steadfast love and gave him favor in the sight of the chief jailer. The chief jailer committed to Joseph's care all the prisoners who were in the prison, and whatever was done there, he was the one who did it. The chief jailer paid no heed to anything that was in Joseph's care, because the Lord was with him. And whatever he did, the Lord made it prosper. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. A couple of years ago in the Atlantic magazine, the author of one of the articles asked the question, if you could go back in time and you could change one thing, what would it be? The Atlantic asked several university professors their thoughts. Duke professor and economist Sandy Darity wrote, "I wish that radical reconstruction had been made a reality after the end of the Civil War. This would have entailed the promised 40-acre land grants to the formerly enslaved, their right to full political participation, assurance of control over their children's schooling, protection by the Union Army in the South, and the arming of the freedmen for self-defense." Maria Warner of the University of London wishes that Ferdinand and Isabella had torn up the Alhambram Decree, which drove the Jews out of Spanish territory. She wrote, "History would look very different if the coexistence of Jews, Muslims, and Christians had continued in 1492. Rutgers professor Samantha Kelly has a suggestion that may surprise many of us. She wishes that agriculture had never been invented. "Imagine," she wrote, "far less environmental degradation and income inequality, a shorter work day for all, a varied diet, and possibly better health outcomes for certain communities, and a profound confidence that the future would provide. A world without industrial agriculture would pretty much be like the Eden of the Bible. Hunter-gatherer life isn't sounding so bad." One of the readers of the article wrote this, "Had President John F. Kennedy not been assassinated in 1963, it is unlikely that he would have escalated America's involvement in Vietnam. That seminal moment in Dallas changed the trajectory of America, and its impact is still being felt today." Another reader jokingly responded to the article saying this, "I'd let Rocky Balboa beat Apollo Creed during their first match, thereby saving humanity from 43 years of Rocky sequels and spinoffs." How about you? What would you change if you could change one thing? Would you have prevented the assassination of Abraham Lincoln? Or how about the overthrow of Adolf Hitler before World War II? How about saving Jesus from the agony of the cross? In the book of Genesis, a man named Jacob settled in the land of Canaan. He had 12 sons, and one of them was named Joseph. Jacob loved Joseph more than any other of his children, says Genesis, because he was the son of his old age, and Jacob made Joseph a long robe with sleeves, sometimes that coat of many colors, as Pastor Gian shared with us. You can imagine, can't you, how his brothers responded? They hated him, and they couldn't speak peaceably to him. In addition, Joseph was a dreamer, and one of his dreams contained the message that his brothers, all older, would bow down to him. And when they heard this, they hated him even more because of his dreams, Scripture says, and his words. If you could go back in time and change history, would you go back and say to Jacob the father, don't play favorites with Joseph? Don't you know he's a little bit of a brat and that his brothers hate him? At age 17, Joseph was shepherding the flocks with his older brother. He was their helper. Four of them were misbehaving in the field, and Joseph brought a bad report to Daddy. He threw him under the bus. If you could travel back in time, might you say to Joseph, don't be a snitch. You see, your brothers are going to terminate you. And sure enough, the situation went from bad to worse. Jacob one day sent Joseph to check on his brothers as they were watching the flocks. Joseph traveled after them and found them in the place called Dothan, and his brothers saw him, Scripture says, from a distance. Who couldn't miss him with that neon lit up kind of coat of many colors? Before he came near to them, Scripture says, they conspired to kill him. The brothers said to one another, here comes this dreamer. Come now, let us kill him and throw him into one of the pits. Then we shall say that a wild animal has devoured him, and we shall see what will become of his dreams. Thankfully, the elder brother Reuben talked to his younger brothers and said, let's not take his life. Let's just throw him into the pit. Reuben's plan, it seems to be, was to free Joseph and return him to his father. Give Reuben some credit. He made a good decision in the midst of a tragic, tragic situation. One of the things that we will see over the next several weeks, that God, through the power of the Holy Spirit, was not just working in Joseph's life, but in many others. In seemingly insignificant decisions and actions will have profound consequences in the life of the people of God. When Joseph came to his brothers, they seized him, they stripped him of his robe and threw him into that empty pit, and then sold him to the Ishmaelites for 20 pieces of silver. And the Ishmaelites took him to Egypt. As the story of Joseph and his brothers begin, it makes us want to go back in time and to make changes, doesn't it? Why not? Most of us can think of positive changes that would have changed history and improved the world, whether it is for protecting the Jews in the 15th century Spain, or saving Lincoln from assassination, or supporting Reconstruction after the Civil War, overthrowing Adolf Hitler before World War II began. All would have been good for God's people in some serious turmoil. But we should never forget, sisters and brothers, we should never forget that God is always working, and that God is working for surprising conclusions, even when humans are acting in horrible, horrible ways. In the book of Genesis, Joseph was sold to Potiphar, one of Pharaoh's officials. That seems bad. But Joseph found favor with Potiphar in Potiphar's sight and was put in charge of Potiphar's house. That's good. Then Potiphar's wife saw how handsome Joseph was and said she wanted to lie with him. That's bad. But over and over and over again, Joseph refused. That's good. Yet Potiphar's wife accused Joseph of misconduct, and she had him thrown into prison. That's really bad. But God continued to show him love and give him favor in the sight of the jailer. And that was good. Bad, good, bad, good, bad, good. Clearly, God, with a steadfast love, is always working toward a surprising conclusion, even when humans are misbehaving. If we're to go back in time and to change history, we might disrupt the work that God is doing in us and in our church and in the world. But for humans, it seems that it's a natural inclination to want to go back, to what we know, instead of moving forward to the place that God has planned for us and is already preparing and moving us towards. Think about the nation of Israel in the book of Exodus. After the Lord had freed them from enslavement in Egypt, when things got challenging on the way to the promised land, they wanted to go back to Egypt. Moses had to contend with some leaders who expressed a wish to go back to Egypt, where they had been enslaved and they had been abused for years and years and years. Those leaders had their focus on what they already knew, slavery in Egypt, instead of looking forward to the promised land and where God was leading them. They were more comfortable looking in the rearview mirror at where they had been and what they knew, instead of looking forward to where God was taking them. This can be a modern problem as well. Nearly every institution more than a few months or a few years old has a Back to Egypt committee. It's typically self-appointed. It's made up of stakeholders who sort to want to kind of keep things just as they are. Nothing should change. Traditions should be honored. New leadership respects the culture of the institution. They represent the culture of the institution. Nothing changes, by the way. Oh yeah, I said that twice. And maybe in the pandemic, this pandemic in which we are in, we might add a sixth characteristic. We all likely crave that which once was. Kay Katan, in her book, Being the Church in a Post-Pandemic World, has written about the disruption and the displacement and the destruction that's been caused by the pandemic. You see, the pandemic is not a pause, she says, that once we gotta get through this, then we are gonna go right back to where we are. In fact, she writes that the pandemic has accelerated change that was already happening in our church and in the world. Institutions, including churches, are struggling to move forward, even if they're not going backwards. But as followers of Jesus Christ, we're called to live into God's dream. Pastor Gian talked about that last week, God's dream for us and for the world. You can see that message online if you didn't see it last week. God's dream, and inviting the Holy Spirit into our lives so that we're not merely surviving, but we're thriving. You see, that's what Joseph allowed the Spirit to do in the ups and the downs of his life. In spite of Scripture not saying anything about Joseph's prayer life, I believe that Joseph must have been a prayer warrior. He was someone who trusted in God's steadfast love and who asked over and over and over again for God's breakthroughs in his life. Such prayers activated God's power in his life and the passion within Joseph. And it can do the same for you and me also. Those who pray regularly for God's new possibilities and open doors find themselves habitually looking up and out with holy expectation. As we set aside our own preferences for God's preferences, as we make room for God's preferences in our hearts and in our minds, and then we make space to discern and to pursue God's next steps forward. In fact, God's future for us becomes irresistible when we do those things. Today and all of your tomorrows, and mine as well, I invite us to hold fast to God's steadfast love for us in every time and every place, every institution, in every situation. God is working God's purposes out. Sometimes we humans don't cooperate very well with God's purpose, but sometimes we do. But nothing deters God in the work of saving people like you and me and helping God's children just like us to live abundant lives. Even the bad things that we would like to change, whether it is in the history of the world or even our own personal history, can be transformed into good. You see, God is that great. God is that loving. God is that glorious. God is that almighty for you and for me and for the world. You see, God is not responsible for the evil that people do, but history shows us that God can turn bad into good. God did it in the life of Joseph and his brothers. God did it in the life of Jesus. You see, nothing is wasted with God. When Joseph's brothers sold him into slavery, they set the stage for his rise in Egypt. When Jesus died and was buried, and buried in that tomb, he was put in the place to rise again for all of humanity and all of creation. Each of us has committed sins. Each of us has suffered defeats. Each of us has made terrible mistakes, and we have been terribly treated at some time in our lives. And while we may want to jump back on a time machine and change the past, we must remember that in our lives, God is always at work turning evil into good. Because nothing is wasted by God. There is no point to turning back and trying to change history. Instead, we are called to trust. You and I are called to trust in God's steadfast. Can you say that? Steadfast. I mean, say it like you believe it. Come on. Steadfast. And we are called to trust in God's steadfast love, now and forever. Let us pray. We praise you, O God, for your steadfast love towards us. Thank you, Lord, for your never-failing faithfulness and comfort and grace, which is new every morning and refreshes us each day. We thank you that you are a God who cares for each of us, and we are all your children. And Lord, we thank you that you have given us your Spirit, that through that Spirit you help us to seek and to trust your plan for us and for this church and for your world. Help us to look forward to where you are leading and not where we've been. Help us to look up and to look out with holy expectation and to set aside our own preferences in order to make room to pursue your next steps forward. It is in Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, Amen.
At this time, we praise our Lord with our morning tithes and offerings. An offering is one of our spiritual disciplines. Giving is not easy, but as we give, God enables us to learn and experience God's amazing work, multiplying our gifts and offerings and providing surprising gifts to us, to the whole world. That's why we give and share what we have with a joyful and thankful heart. At this time, I'd like to invite our ushers to come forward to receive our morning tithes and offerings. And a quick reminder, please place your completed Connect card on the offering plate. Would you pray with me? Merciful God, we give you thanks for your steadfast love. This time, we give back to you our tithes and offerings, and once again dedicate ourselves to you. Receive our hearts and overflowing joy in our faith. Enable us to experience fullness in our hearts and spirit as we share ours with neighbors and empty ourselves for you and others. Bless our gifts and lives, and do a miraculous work that feeds the hungry, fills empty hearts, and teaches and proclaims your unconditional and steadfast love in the world. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Where I am found, all I have I give. stand arms open wide. Oh, 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 I am yours and you are mine.
Friends, let's stand and sing together our last song going out. For God standing with us.
Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. Even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back. I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. If my God is with me, whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear? Hold up, you never let go, through the storm, through the storm.
We praise you for never letting go of us. And now, sisters and brothers, we leave this place to go out in the strength of the Holy Spirit, to go in the love of God, to go in the fellowship of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Go in the steadfast love of God. Amen.